Thanks, everybody. I'm happy to call our meeting to order. And I would like to begin by thanking you all once again for spending the time this afternoon, both at the retreat and for our meeting this afternoon. And that as well to those of us, to those of you who are on the phone, thank you for joining us. So meeting is called to order, and I would be happy to accept a motion to accept the minutes. If there are no additions, deletions, or corrections, motion made by Ms. Commissioner Persico. Is there a second?
Second.
Yes, Bishop Badger, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed. Thank you, that motion carries. We have a number of resolutions that we'd like to present to the board. We'll begin first with Commissioner Persico. And by the way, I hope you all know that it was announced the other day that that Jen was appointed to the NFTA Board of Commissioners heretofore. So a big round of applause for Jen. Heretofore known as Commissioner. And if any of you have any parking issues at the airport, please call her directly. Yeah, well, and or any bus questions.
Bus questions, right. Bring those tokens out from the 70s. I'm going to make sure we start taking them again. Thank you very much, Mr. Candies. I am presenting to the board a resolution from the Contracts Committee. As the board is aware, the Contracts Committee reviews contracts that are in excess of 1 year. I think that everybody has a list of those contracts in front of you. The committee has carefully considered those contracts with the assistance of counsel for ECMC. And now I would request a motion, or maybe Tony, I can make this motion, that the board accept the resolution.
Motion has been made by the commissioners. Is there a second?
Second,
Sharon Hansen. Any further discussion, question, comment on the contract presented? Seeing none, we'll come immediately to a vote. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And opposed? Thank you, that motion carries. We'll move to the second resolution. Mr. Colucci.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. The second resolution was included in your packet, and it authorizes a transfer of funds to Grider Community Gardens. Those of you who are present during our retreat session, you know that Grider Community Gardens holds title to 18 parcels on Grider Street and is also in the process of examining opportunities for the corporation to purchase additional land in that vicinity. The resolution that's been proffered to the board with the recommendation of the CEO requests that ECMCC transfer $500,000 to the operating account of Grider Community Gardens, both to acquire new properties and to pay the costs associated with maintaining the existing 18 properties.
Motion has been made by Commissioner Persico, seconded by Ms. Hansen. Further questions? Any further comments, Tony, that you want to make on the motion? Anyone have any questions either on the phone or in the building? Seeing none, we'll come to a vote. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 And to the contrary, that motion carries as well. Thank you. Mr. Colucci on DISRA, please.
Yes, the third item for your consideration today deals with the transition of Millennium Collaborative Care as the DISRA program winds down. Millennium is required, actually ECMC is required, to file a transition plan on August the 3rd, 2020. That plan needs to be approved by the board, and it was sent to you late last week by Jeffra. I don't believe there were any questions, but before it can be sent in, the board needs to approve it, and then Dr. Quattrocci needs to certify that the board has in fact reviewed and approved it.
Motion is being made by Dr. Grimm, seconded by Commissioner Persico. Questions, comments? Anyone on the phone? Seeing none, we'll come immediately to a vote. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 And opposed? Thank you as well. That motion carries. On the naming of spaces and structures, Dr. Quattrocci, please.
Yep. So before you have a list of capital campaign donors that have name recognition spaces, and we're looking for the board's approval.
Motion, Motion been made by Congressman Quinn. Second, Commissioner Persico. Thank you. Any further questions for Dr. Quattrocchi on the motion? Seeing none, we'll come immediately to a vote on that. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 And to the contrary, that motion carries as well. Thank you. And on the medical dental staff meeting minutes, I assume. Oh, Dr. Flynn, please. Maybe we need to unmute him.
Oh, Mr. Chairman, I'm ready to go with my report. Thank you for the opportunity. The Credentials Committee reports 25 initial appointments to the staff, 40 reappointments, and there were 9 resignations. There was one change of status from consult, refer, and follow to active status. And that concludes my report.
And I know I'm not under any anesthesia, but he does sound like the sound of God. Sorry, everybody. Dr. Flynn has made the motion. Is there a second?
So moved.
Thank you. Any questions for Dr. Flynn? All in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
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 And opposed. That motion carries as well. Now the report from Dr. Quattrocchi. Please, Tom.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to try to go through these slides quickly. Okay, so just again, COVID update, where we're at with our COVID patients. We've had 232 COVID patients. We actually have only one patient in-house and one patient under investigation. So we're very, again, proud of our team and what they've been able to do. I know Dr. Izzo and others have been working on a study about how our care has been going with regard to these patients and the fact that we actually had a lot of success with the treatment of our patients. So looking forward to talking to the board about that at a later time. The next slide is regarding our journey to zero and our caudies and CLABSIs. We only had one in June, CLABSI and one in caudie in June. And obviously, again, just a testament to the team and their ability to take care of our patients when we have had very, very sick patients in the building. I'm not going to read all the grants. We received a few grants. We're very proud of our grants department for continuing to work on securing dollars for ECMC. Nurse leadership had a boot camp for COVID-19. We had 105 nurses participate in that. So again, very very engaged nurses in the building and really talking about the care that we're providing for our patients, because obviously the clinical care has changed and there's been a lot of updates to the clinical care as the crisis has continued on. And we've had 33 successful applications for clinical ladder. If you may remember, we have a process within our union contract for our nurses for them to advance themselves. And actually, as they do, they receive more compensation. And it's been going very, very well, a program that was really pushed for by Karen Zemanski, our Senior Vice President of Nursing. 16 nurses completed trauma care TCAR course. Again, more, adding to our quality of care and our certifications. We have an initiative called BRAVE, and it's Buffalo Rising Against Violence. We've had 413 patients served since 1-1-20. At a later board meeting, I'm going to have Karen do a presentation on this program. It is really an amazing program and has helped a lot of patients. Joanne Wolf, RN, completed clinical graduation from the Greater New York Clinical Quality Fellowship Program. We celebrated our MICU Beacon Award, as we said earlier. We were one of only 16 places in New York State to receive this award for MICU. As you know, our MICU was the front lines of COVID. And here's a picture with the team in celebration of that national achievement. Patient experience, our scores continue to be very, very strong, continuing through COVID. And I just want to, very proud of the team for the work they've been doing around patient experience. Culture, we had a celebration for Juan Phillips' discharge. As you know, Officer Phillips was with us for quite some time, was very, very sick. was in the ICU, I think, multiple times, and really an inspiration to everybody, an inspiration to our community. A company by the name of Mantinelli donated an RV for our testing site. So we did a recognition for them. And he's looking pretty cool over there in the shades on the side there, if you can see that. ECMC, we've been doing summer surge trucks, food trucks. The employees have really appreciated that. DAISY Award, we do an award, as you know, and we receive hundreds of nominations from patients or nurses for our DAISY Award. The nurses, you know, this is a very special award for our nurses because it's from the patients. We had a thank you for all the COVID testers, they just really did a phenomenal job and continue to do a phenomenal job for testing for our employees in our community as the weather's been very, very hot. So they've been outside doing this testing and just are very, very dedicated individuals. Continuing on to operations, Terrace View visitation is going to be resuming 28 days after our last positive COVID test. So it should be August, I believe, correct? Are we still on track for August? Yep. And our Terrace View search continues for an administrator for Terrace View. That process is going very well. We talked about our ED observation unit being up, and Dr. Fry starting for plastic reconstructive surgery, and we were awarded a $98,000 grant for telehealth. The windows project, this is actually a little dated. That whole row of windows you see halfway down is done, and we're on to the next, but the project is in full swing, and Jim Turner and his team have been doing a phenomenal job. I'm just gonna turn it over to Andy very, very quickly. We just wanna let the board know of our efforts for preparing for a possible surge in the fall. We don't have a scheduled board meeting in August, so we thought it was important at this meeting that we just give you a very high level view of what we're doing to make sure we're prepared for September. So go ahead, Andy. Here, let's flip it.
Real quickly, kind of managing a pandemic. When the pandemic started, we started the command center, and it's located on the third floor. We started having task force meetings every day at 8 o'clock. We now have moved those to twice a week on Monday to Thursday, and we continue to report to the state and also and county officials. And as we continue to, we'll continue to review changes for compliance. Tom kind of gave you the update. We currently still have only one positive patient, COVID positive patient in the facility. And we have had 232 patients that have been positive with 44 people who have expired with 181 discharges. And that also gives you the breakdown by sex. So the next wave, we reviewed our surge plan for cohorted patients. Most of our patients, if they have COVID, will be on the 12th floor. We just started our observation unit that has given us more capacity. And so we're very pleased with that. And then we'll continue to have our testing plan. As you know, we still use a RV to do testing outside the facility, and that will continue. And then just to talk about supplies really quickly, our PPE currently is in really good shape. We will comply with a 60-day requirement by August 31 to have 60 days on hand and also 90 days on hand. Most of those areas, masks, gloves, eye protection, gowns, and respiratory supplies, we're almost there as we speak. And then ventilator support, we currently have 70 ventilators on hand. A few months ago, we did make the decision to try to order more. As you can imagine, that order has taken some time, but we do expect for delivery date in mid-October, it was 22, which would almost take us just under almost a 92 ventilators. Any questions?
Andy, I just wanted to add that from a staff perspective, we're gonna continue to do what we did during the crisis, which was work with individuals regarding childcare, if that becomes an issue with schools. We gave, obviously, people who needed to quarantine or got sick, We gave them the necessary 14 days where they did not need to use their time. We had hotel rooms for individuals if they felt like they were working on a floor and they didn't want to go home. And many other efforts that we did, helping people find childcare, all kinds of initiatives to make sure we supported our employees. So just wanted to let the board know we're prepared to do those things again. If God forbid we have a surge, but we will be prepared in any case. Any other questions or thoughts? Okay, just for the next slide, I want to talk about the volumes. So volumes are starting to come back. July is actually about 10% higher in discharges. In June, you'll see we don't have an all red grid. We have some yellow in that we were down about 30 patients from budget for the month of June. Observation cases are way down, which is, I think, a good thing, in that we're, I think, more appropriately admitting patients. And you'll see surgeries are actually up from the previous June. So all in all, we're beginning to bring volume back. And again, July is proving to be a very, very busy, very, very busy month. So with that, Mr. Chair, if it's okay, I'll turn it over to John for the financial piece.
Thanks, Tom.
So the good news here is, as Tom said before I leave this slide, is that we are starting to see some signs of recovery. This is the first month in several, and it's translating into, albeit better financial results, but certainly not where we need to be yet. But as you can see, as Tom mentioned, we're only about 30 discharges off of budget this month, which is actually the best month's performance all year. And certainly, as it relates to how that's translating into July, we are seeing indicators in July that are indicative of better performance. Our current performance just to budget during the month of July is higher than planned for discharges and right on plan for inpatient and outpatient surgeries, which indicates certainly a stronger operational month for the month of July. And so that's translated during the month of June. As you can see here, again, I've shown these the last couple of months. In this slide here is a combination slide, actually, of both inpatient and outpatient surgeries, just showing the board the dip that we did see, the significant dip specifically in both of these areas, starting on around March 18th, and then starting to recover in late May. And since that point in time, in late June into early July, we are starting to see levels in surgeries that are at or above our pre-COVID surgical levels. We've added a slide this month to show the board the emergency room visits as well by week, showing the steep decline, of course, right around the same time, and then starting to really see an increase into May, and then, of course, a steady increase in by far and away above our pre-COVID levels in ED visits. And although there's not an arrow here, you can see a steep increase during the week ending June 7th. That was the week that we actually opened the new emergency department, and the levels have been at that level since then. And so that has translated for the month of June, as I said, better performance, although we still are seeing an operating loss given the COVID costs that we did continue to see and some lost revenue even during June. And that's a $10.4 million operating loss for the month. And that's before CARES Act funding relief that was recognized during the month. So that nets to about a $3.7 million operating loss. And when added to the rest of the months prior to that, for the year-to-date performance, that results in about a $72.4 million operating loss before any CARES Act relief that we've recognized of about $27.8 million, netting down to about $44.6 million in operating losses. And that $27.8 million does not include the latest round of awarded CARES Act funds, and that will be recorded in future months as we continue to meet the eligibility requirements set forth by Department of Health and Human Services. So as we continue to track our COVID-related costs through the end of the month of June, and of course this is a snapshot in time and doesn't necessarily stop at the end of June, our lost revenue for that period is about $44 million, and as we've compounded the costs continuing through June, those total about $16.6 million. So our total impact to the organization is about $60.7 million through the end of June. Operationally though, without the capital component of that, that's impacted our income statement negatively by about $59.4 million through the end of June. For all the reasons we've talked about and for sustainability reasons, we've monitored cash all the way through. We have been had our eye on the cash position, trying to bolster that since day one of the pandemic. As you can see here, our days cash on hand is strong at the end of June, bolstered in part by the Medicare loans that we've received. Those loans are set to begin to be paid back starting in July and will go through the end of the year under the current legislation, unless something is acted upon. And that takes me to the next subject, which is the latest iteration of Federal CARES Act relief. There are still are undisbursed funds that had been approved. And then, of course, there are bills before Congress and the Senate as we speak that are being negotiated, the result of which we won't know yet. But they do have some relief built in, as well as some relief as it relates to the payback of the Medicare loan. But that process is yet to be determined at this point. And of course, we're continuing to track any and all opportunities as it relates to cash flow and making sure we're partnering with our payers if we can. We've had one payer who's been very, very significant partner throughout all of this and has extended that advance payment through the end of July. And so again, grants, as Tom mentioned, we're continuing to get those on a regular basis through our grant request process and the grant program that we have in the facility. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, John. Any questions for John on finances? Comments? Thank you, John. Thank you, Tom. Very quickly, I would just say this about our executive committee continues to marvel, and I think the board should equally be as impressed as we have come through this extraordinary, life-changing, generational impact of COVID. We have managed to somehow maintain our patient scores, at least be cognizant and recognize what our financial position is in a very organized, methodical way, taking advantage of whatever revenue opportunities are there, and open up a brand new emergency room trauma center with barely a hiccup. And I think that speaks to the just extraordinary job that Tom and Andy and Dr. Murray and Karen and the entire staff and senior team does. And that should not be minimized. In fact, needs to be celebrated, not only by the board, but by the community. We seemingly, despite all that, not missed a step. And in the middle of all of this, Jim Turner continues to build the project out on our campus. So thank you guys. And just a continuing job well done. It's almost, you know, we sort of do the unexpected and it's become sort of the rule. So I can't tell you how much we appreciate and the community appreciates all that you've done. So thank you. Mike Seaman, I know, had to go. John, is there anything from the Finance Committee that we want to talk about? Mike had to leave. So we're good. Mike Hoffert, anything on QI?
Yeah, John. We had our Board Quality Improvement and Patient Safety Committee meeting virtually on Tuesday, July 14th at 8 a.m. We had presentations by Dr. Michael Manka on emergency medicine. That was very interesting, particularly with the opening of the new emergency department. We also had an orthopedic medicine presentation by Dr. Stegman. Family medicine by Dr. Richard Lugo. Pathology by Dr. Lucia Bellows, and Rapid Response and Code Committee by Nurse Mary Reinhardt. Really, every one of them was a phenomenal presentation. That Mary Reinhardt, she always just amazes me though when she talks about our great nurses, John. We also had a presentation from Donna Jones on the Quality Leadership Council, of which we accepted their minutes. So unless anybody has any questions, that concludes my report.
Thank you, Mike. Any questions for Mike? Seeing none, Tony, there's no reason to, no items for executive session? Okay, thank you. Before we adjourn, I do want to once again thank and on behalf of the board, thank you, Keith, for just a great job in putting that deck together. Keith is going to do that presentation again starting at 7 o'clock tonight, if any of you are interested. He will also have autographed copies of it if you're interested in taking it home. But that really will frame what we're going to be doing for the future. So, Keith, thank you. And Sue Gonzalez, thank you. Jeffra, thank you for getting this all done. And unless there's any new and or old business, I'm happy to entertain a motion to adjourn. Motions have been made, seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, everybody. Stay safe, and we'll see you next month, or in 2 months, actually.
Best wishes, everyone. Take care.